It was just a couple of weeks before my board exams that Rang De Basanti had hit the theatres. It was a time when popular Hindi cinema was producing one mediocre film after another. Rang De Basanti provided a welcome break to that chain. Not only was this film a huge commercial success, it also managed to stir the consciousness of the youth. The results were evident when the youth participated in Anna Hazare's fight against corruption with overwhelming numbers. Much has been said about the Rang De Basanti effect, but little discourse has happened on his content that will peel off the layers hidden under his obvious narrative. In other words, on his style and substance. The film seems to have two parallel narratives. One is about the present time and the other about the struggle during Indian freedom movement. The parallel narratives in its real sense is just a cinematic illusion. The seamless blend of the historical and the present events allow us to forget that it's Sue's recreation of those events based on her grandfather's memoir. And this is not Chandrasekhar Azad. This is DJ playing Chandrasekhar Azad. Once you keep this thing in mind, then the gradual character arcs become apparent. Quentin Tarantino has portrayed one aspect of Rang De Basanti throughout his filmography. His every film contains at least one character playing some other character in a way that will affect the film's diegetic universe.
Well, I speak the most Italian, so I'll be your escort. Donovan speaks second most, so he'll be your Italian cameraman. Omar third most, so he'll be Donnie's assistant.
I don't speak Italian.
But during the act, you can never break character.
It's an interesting point. Come on, let's get into character.
Superhero films have also explored this thing.
When Superman wakes up in the morning, he's Superman. His alter ego is Clark Kent. His outfit with the big red S, those are his clothes. What Kent wears, the glasses, the business suit, that's the costume.
But the film from which Rang De Basanti seems to have borrowed his structure is the 1989 Canadian film Jesus of Montreal. This film portrays a group of actors presenting an acclaimed passion play. After a while, their life starts to mirror the passion itself. Now, there are people who are quick to accuse Rakeish Mehra of plagiarism here. But I don't think there's anything wrong with borrowing a narrative structure. Scorsese borrowed the structure of The Searchers to make Taxi Driver. Anurag Kashyap borrowed the structure of Goodfellas and City of God to make Gangs of Wasseypur. So I'm glad that Rakeish Mehra introduced the Indian audiences to a new storytelling structure. Another thing that struck me the most was his use of conscious camera. I have always been a fan of Binod Pradhan's work, but Rang De Basanti was something that stood out for me from the moment I saw it. The way he uses variable frame rates in a single shot adds a sense of consciousness of time, while making us enter inside character's head. The subdued movement of the handheld camera provides an immediacy and a sense of personal involvement. Sometimes Pradhan will open camera shutter angle while shooting at lower frame rates. This technique provides each frame a feel straight out of an impressionist painting, like that of Monet, Renoir, or Van Gogh. A lot of time, instead of cutting to another actor, the director uses whip pan to reach to that actor. These whip pans also act as a motif to connect multiple events. I would like to give special regards here to the director Rakeish Omprakash Mehra for his short compositions. These days, the possible television broadcast of the film make the studio so concerned that the directors are forced to compose their shots to fit the aspect ratio of the television. But Mehra didn't care about that one bit. The decision was partly fueled by the ensemble staging and partly by Mehra's purest vision towards cinema. In a film with an abundance of brilliant compositions, meticulous staging and precise blocking, there is this one thing that stands out. This camera angle, which seems to appear at whim. But there is more to it than meets the eye. This particular camera angle is called the Dutch angle. Generally, this tilted camera angle is used to portray psychological uneasiness or tension in the subject. Most movies use it sparingly. Rang De Basanti largely uses it as a stylistic device. But sometimes it does serve its intended purpose, like this shot of Ajay.
Hey guys, what's up?
It works as an immediate foreshadowing, as this happens to be the last night he'll spend with his friends.
Koi mar gaya kya?
But there's no better scene than this one, which displays Mehra's genius. In the first few short exchanges, Sue breaks the silence carried forward from the previous scene. Ajay then starts the conversation. The sped-up version of the scene from this point on clearly shows that except for one close-up of Sukhi, not a single shot in the rest of the scene is stable. Considering the fact that their life is going to turn upside down over the course of this film, such style is absolutely fitting. We'll come back to this scene later. Now, this film's use of narrative style and film form would have been enough to make it a great film. But what makes it so appealing among a large section of crowd, and especially among the youth, is its content, the substance. To modify John Lasseter's quote, "The art challenges the society inspires the art." If you look at the pre-independent Hindi cinema, it was all about anti-British sentiments. The post-independent cinema reflected a sense of nation-building. This led to some purposeful films where the hero was singing, but in the name of nation building, we became an importing nation, as Raj Kapoor sang,
"Mera juta hai Japani, ye patloon Englishtani, sar pe laal topi rusi, phir bhi dil hai Hindustani."
But when the ground reality struck and the poverty started to take its toll, it was reflected in Gurudas' cinema when he asked,
"Jinhe naaz hai Hind par wo kahan hai, kahan hai, kahan hai, kahan hai."
The art challenged the society inspired the art. Rang De Basanti was released in the wake of absurdity around Jessica Lal's murder case. The unrest towards the long history of MiG-21 planes' fatal accidents was rising with each passing year. The corruption was seemingly growing faster than the computer technology. Rang De Basanti blended the entire nation's frustration and the feeling of helplessness. A cry was made at the end to take the personal responsibility of the matters concerning the nation.
पुलिस में भर्ती होंगे, मिलिट्री ज्वाइन करेंगे, आईएएस बनेंगे, पॉलिटिक्स का हिस्सा बनकर इस देश की सरकार चलाएंगे।
Now at the age of 17, the decisions the characters made in the film felt kind of right to me. But now that I'm 10 years older, and I like to think a little wiser, I have my ideological differences towards those decisions. But that will require a whole other video. The overflow of patriotism is something that is hard for me to digest even now. I mean, come on, there's no need for that in a romantic song. But shrouded under the coating of the ideological conflicts lie an argument dense with debates from thousands of years. In an enormous and complex labyrinth of Hindu philosophy, there is a concept of Varna system introduced in Rig Veda. It says that each person belongs to any one of the four Varnas. This system gave everyone a reason for their existence and a purpose to their lives, which was follow your dharma. Now jump a couple of thousand years ahead, where Plato and Aristotle introduced the idea of essence, a set of co-properties essential for a thing to be what it is. Just like Hinduism, Plato and Aristotle also believed that the essence of a person was hardwired by God. In the late 1800s, Friedrich Nietzsche proposed an idea of nihilism, the belief in the ultimate meaningless in life. Then came French philosopher Jean-Paul Sartre, who asked, "What if we are born without any purpose, and then it is up to us to choose our essence and follow it through our actions?" This became the framework for existentialism. Now, I know I'm skirting around a vast school of philosophy here, but here's my point. We all have been through the struggle of not being able to choose our essence. Sometimes, the struggle reaches a point where we question our existence and the purpose of life itself, ultimately trapping ourselves in an existential crisis. That's where these characters come in the picture. Sue, Sonia and Ajay seems to have found their essence. But Aslam is trapped in an identity crisis surrounding his religion. Sukhi is struggling with the clouded possibility of him ever getting in a relationship. Lakshman seems to have an essence forced on him to such a degree that he has turned a blind eye towards the reality. DJ is aware of the trappings of the outside world and is not prepared to face it anytime soon.
Aur duniya mein acche acche DJ pis gaye lakhon ki bheed mein.
Finally, Karan expresses a sense of nihilism towards the condition of the nation and wants to run away from it as soon as possible.
Ajay, tu desh ko perfect banate reh, main jis din degree mili kat lunga America, mera kuch nahi hone wala is pure dal mein.
Now let's come back to this scene, because all of this culminate in this one scene. Aslam is aware that he doesn't have an essence. As the conversation moves forward, both Aslam and Karan expresses their growing sense of nihilism.
Soo, tum bahar se aayi ho, isliye tumhare liye na ye sab kehna bahut aasan hai. Yahan par zinda rehne ki ladai mein logon ki zindagiyan nikal jati hain. Basics ke chakkar mein roti, kapda aur ek chhat.
Yahan pe system ko badalne ki koshish karo. सिस्टम खुद तुम्हें बदलता है। सब माँ के पेट से सीख के आते हैं ना बेईमानी और करप्शन। कोई फ्यूचर नहीं यार इस देश का।
अजय एंड सोनिया रिफ्यूज्ड बाय सेइंग दैट इट इज देम हु आर रिफ्यूजिंग टू चूज एन एसेंस।
अगर तुम्हें इतना प्रॉब्लम है तो तुम बदलो ना इस देश को, ये तुम्हारा भी देश है। पॉलिटिक्स ज्वाइन करो, पुलिस या आईएएस में भर्ती हो जाओ, बदलो चीजों को।
But as the idea goes, you can't force an essence on anyone.
तो कुछ नहीं बदलेगा यार, ऐसे ही होता है, ऐसे ही होता रहेगा। इधर तुम शुरुआत करो, वहां तुम्हारा दी एंड हो जाएगा।
करेक्ट, बस अलग होगा तो तुम्हारा दी एंड द स्टाइल।
लाइफ इन द एंड सीम्स टू हैव वेरी लिटिल पर्पस।
कुछ भी कर ले यारा, कली का कुत्ता भी नहीं पोकेगा हमारे मरने पे।
Then the tragedy strikes. A fateful occurrence provides them with an essence in the form of revenge, which grows into something larger than what they had set out to do. But the end of the film feels like a slap in the face. An Orwellian way of concluding the film leaves the audience empty and dissatisfied, questioning the purpose once again when it seems like they had just found it. Now this was an intelligent way of telling a story, and if you were a young film goer like me, it was hard not to get affected by a film like this. There is an argument put forward by mediocre filmmakers that the common people of India don't want to be forced with heavy material. But it felt like Rang De Basanti's enormous success had put that argument to bed once and for all. Expectation grew towards popular Hindi cinema to make intelligent and uncompromising content. But what happened? Except for one or two mainstream films, our minds had been fed with one garbage after another, stacking an unparalleled pile of shit. Things have gone so bad that the voices trying to stir the consciousness of the society are being silenced in the name of censorship. But if we have learned anything from the history, it is that there is a pervading generational existentialism, fueling ideas and actions for thousands of years. Good ideas will always find their way to reach out. The question is, are we listening?